Hi, good morning. Happy Monday, everyone. Today, Calgary Zone Jeff Kahane is going to give us some tips on the mistakes that buyers and sellers make the most in real estate. This is our girl, Melina, from Positive Match. She's looking for a foster home. Please consider fostering. Fostering does save lives. It takes them out of the shelter situation and gives them a nice place to stay before transitioning into their forever home. Let's have a look at Melina. Today we have a very special guest, one of our best lawyers here in Calgary, real estate law and family law, right, Jeff?
Not me, I like the happy law, but we've got a crew of them downstairs.
Okay, awesome. So he's going to give us some pointers today on things to watch out for when you're in the middle of a real estate transaction. So Jeff, take it away.
Sure. So first, let's just say, make sure you get yourself a good real estate agent because it's so important. It's going to be personal relationship stuff, skill sets, and you'll get a feel for do they seem like they know what they're talking about or do they not? What does your gut tell you? It's like you can't pass that off. You're also going to have to pick a lawyer. How do you do that? And I'm not just going to say, oh, everyone come here because not everyone can. This is the internet. One, see if you can find a flat rate fee. Find out what they're going to charge you total in advance instead of this mysterious fee plus disbursements where you don't know what you're paying. Two, see how long it takes for them to call you back. So if you're trying to give them work and it's taking them 3 or 4 days, imagine if it's your possession day and you can't get possession, you're just really worried about what's going on, you're gonna wanna speak to someone right away.
Yeah.
And don't get a dabbler. You want someone who has a lot of experience. It's the same as a doctor. A surgeon who does the same procedure over and over and over and over again will be better at it than someone who does it once or twice, you know, every 5 or 10 years.
Right.
So those are my little tips that way. Now, in terms of buyers and sellers, let's start with sellers. How do sellers get themselves into trouble? Not disclosing.
Right.
So there's little secret things you know about your property that could be really negative. Oh, all that black mold. We don't have to mention that. We'll just hide it away. We'll keep it secret. It doesn't really work. Or that leak where the basement floods every spring. So we're gonna make sure we sell in October, and no one will ever know. So those are material latent defects. They're things that a buyer would want to know about. You probably have an obligation to disclose it. Talk to your lawyer, talk to your real estate agent. Those are going to be important things. Next, we see problems with real property reports. There are problems with those all the time, and usually because they're left to the last minute. It is the only, as far as I know, in the listing contracts with the real estate agents, that it says very specifically in bold, the whole deal can fall apart if it's not updated, not in good condition, not proper for the transaction. And we've even seen situations where a seller, the deal collapsed, and they had to pay 10 grand to the buyers for their damages.
Wow.
Don't get in that situation.
No.
If you've added something outside, if things have changed on the property, even if it's been more than a couple years, because the real estate contract has changed and things that were okay before are not okay now, have your lawyer just take a look at it. They shouldn't be charging anything extra. We'd take a look. They can't tell you if there's a garage on the property or not because we don't go to the property. But in terms of overall, it's nice and easy and quick, but deal with it even before you list the property if you can.
Yeah, it's probably one of the first things I tell my sellers in the listing consultation is let's get your RPR dealt with, call a survey company. So great point, continue.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Mm-hmm.
Not being in a position to close. So nothing causes problems like it being a couple days before possession and the lawyers can't send documents to the other lawyer because the sellers just can't sell the property at that point. Why does it happen? Good question. Dower. You want to make sure that you have dower rights dealt with. And people will say, oh, I don't have to worry about dower rights because my spouse signed off on them. If it's in a separation agreement, but you don't actually have a dower release, we still have to find your spouse.
Yes.
If you are legally married, no such thing. If you're legally divorced or legally separated, legal divorce is fine, but no such thing as a legal separation. You can't be legally separated. You're still married.
Yes.
So we've had couples where they're separated for 20, 30 years. Socially, they're available to date all they want, which is great. Legally, have fun.
Yeah.
Dower. We need to get the dower signed off on. Other situations that come up a lot is probate. So people wanting to sell their house, their parent has passed away, someone has passed away, and they've listed the house for sale, but they haven't applied for probate. Can't sell. You can't transfer property until probate goes through. People who are not Canadian residents for tax purposes. So if you've moved to another jurisdiction to avoid high taxes in Canada, and now you're selling your house, you'll probably have to get a clearance certificate from the CRA to make sure that you can sell the property. Not enough money. So that still happens. You have registrations on title for money owing on one mortgage, on a line of credit. Maybe there's a lawsuit or Revenue Canada's coming after you, and there's just not enough money to close. That's going to be a key one that people have to think about. And just separations in general. Your former spouse or soon-to-be former spouse can register what's called a CLP. It's like a place marker on title and really tie up the whole transaction, which puts you in a horrible negotiating space either with the buyer or your spouse.
Right.
So those ones are some key ones.
Right.
Last, for sellers, condos. Before you start selling your parking stall and storage locker as this is the one you get,
make sure you know
what you have.
Right.
We see people who have rented units where they don't actually own it and they can't sell that unit trying to sell it. Usually accidentally, they just don't understand. Assigned ones where someone else gets that one and then you get, the new person gets the bottom of the list in terms of, well, you might have an outdoor stall or something else. Or if there just aren't stalls that are assigned and it's just first come, first serve, make sure you know what you have.
Awesome.
Any questions for sellers?
No, and I think this all goes back to choosing a good and thorough realtor.
Yeah, absolutely.
They should help you through all of this.
They should step you through each and every piece of this as opposed to kind of rushing through things.
Yeah.
It's not just about, oh, you're going to get the toppest dollars of anyone, because anyone can promise you the world. It doesn't necessarily translate. And you know, in a market, if a market's going down and you pick that top dollar and you're always chasing the dollars down, it doesn't work very well.
Right.
But it's just, it's always better to be realistic. Listen closely to those comparables. Make sure, you know, it makes sense what you're asking for, because otherwise, you know, it's just going to sit on the market and not go anywhere.
Time is money.
Yeah. Yeah. And if you want to take a chance on it for a couple weeks, I'm not a realtor. You know, I guess it doesn't hurt to see if there's that perfect buyer.
No.
But be realistic.
Yep. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Awesome. So,
buyers. Love buyers.
We love buyers.
First thing I ever say when we get buyers calling is like, congratulations, because it's super exciting. And I think we run into like some problems sometimes, not intentionally, but someone will go to IKEA over and over and over again when they're picking a bed. But when they're buying a house, it's so emotional. And then they see it and they're wanting to write that offer within an hour. I mean, I'm not with them. That's what you guys do.
Yeah.
And it happens very quick. So you don't see some of the scratches and the dents and the things. Try and take the time to look at that, but just a little forewarning.
Yes.
In that step back, things that we see problems is understanding what you're getting. So you buy a house, you love what you see, you have this dream of putting this beautiful gazebo in the backyard, and no one tells you about things like right-of-ways.
Utility right-of-ways.
Utilities, right. Overland water drainage, those kind of things. You can put the gazebo there. And then we hear, I never would have bought this house if I'd known that I can't put a gazebo. Restrictive covenants. So again, your dream house is the perfect house in the world. If only it was blue, we'll just paint it.
Nope.
Some communities have restrictions and they register on title. So make sure you've gone through
those. Fences too are a big thing.
Types of fences, if you have to have chain link, type of roofing. Sometimes it's type of business or whether you can put a garage within so many feet of a, there are endless number of restrictions.
Right.
If they're on title, you need to know about it. And again, comes back to that good real estate agent.
Pulling
or not.
Title. Yes.
Pulling the title and going over it. Some people will say, oh, you'll go over it with the lawyer. That's great. We can go over with you.
Too late, though, at that point.
Already obligated. They have to buy the property.
Right,
so, well, I guess you can buy it and then sell it again, which is good for everyone but you.
Yeah.
So don't get in that situation. A good hint for that is looking at the real property report. And if your real estate agent can get it for you before you put in the offer, it actually shows you, or as a condition, although you want to be careful how you word those conditions. It shows you. It'll show you where the right-of-ways are. It'll show you what you can and not what you can and can't do, but it'll show you a visual depiction, which is easier to understand. sometimes we have communities where there's a big community fence, and you don't actually own the land between your property line and that fence or something else, or it could be along a city boulevard, and there's a whole bunch of land that's not yours, and you might have visions for it. You need to know. And
yeah,
the RPR
right.
is the best way of doing that.
Yeah.
Again, like a seller not being in a position to close, you want to make sure you have all your money available. Your down payment's important. Part of that's going to be, you know, some people bank with a bank that it takes them a while to get money, or if you're pulling money from RSPs, that might take a while. Sometimes it could be someone's in the middle of a divorce or separation where the funds are tied up until you've finished fighting over things, and you don't want to be in a position where you have to buy this house or get sued, or you've got to give in to every whim that your soon-to-be former wants. So really make sure you've talked to your family law lawyer and that you know that you can buy and everything's okay to buy.
That's and also really your realtor should be in contact with your mortgage broker and with your lawyer, and the mortgage broker should be in contact with your lawyer. It should all be an easy flow of communication between
Our job as a team is to make a buyer's and a seller's life as easy as possible.
Easy as possible and comfortable.
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah. And deal with things, even if they don't even know they're there, that we're polish everything up. A buyer and seller, their worst job in this whole process should be moving their stuff.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Moving it to the new
that
house.
That is your
or
job.
Old house.
Not our job.
We don't help with that at all. No pizza and beer for this guy for that.
Yeah. Okay. And so do you have a couple more points?
Okay, one, again, condo points. Again, we're just going to talk about parking stall and
yes.
So it's going to be the same thing, just from the other side, knowing what you have. Conditions. Conditions are so important. If you have a concern about the property, it is really important to you make sure that you get a condition. And that just means that your whole contract is conditional on you waiving that condition. So if you want to make sure that there are no red dogs in the neighborhood, silly example, and you need a week to look through the neighborhood to make sure there's no red dogs, you can put that condition in the contract.
Add it in.
That one is silly, don't put it in.
But if you perhaps, let's say, want to inspect the foundation.
Foundation, electrical,
foundation. Right.
HVAC systems, insulation, asbestos, videoing the older communities.
Yes.
You can get the sewer lines, scoping those.
Yeah.
It really depends on what's important to you, and communicate. Communication is so important with your real estate agent to make sure that they know, they put it as a condition, and then do not waive that condition until you know you're satisfied. So if someone says you have a condition for financing that's very popular, and then you have a pre-approval, that's not your approval. You need your actual approval. Mm-hmm. And if someone says, oh, don't worry, we'll have it in 2 days, just waive it, don't worry. You say, no, I'm going to waive it when I have it, because you're legally obligated to buy once you sign that waiver. So that's going to be an important one. And just making sure that all those conditions are in there.
Right.
Last, if a seller is supposed to do something, we're going to change the roof for you before your possession date.
Right.
Put it in the contract.
In writing.
In writing in the contract. Oh, yeah, we trust them. It's totally okay.
No.
Not just in writing in the contract. We want a consequence if it's not done.
That's right.
Hold back. And you want to make sure that you know what it's going to cost you to do that work if they haven't done it. So maybe get another quote, get an idea. Like your real estate agent probably isn't the person to ask because they're not trades.
We're not the
trades,
experts on that,
So figure out an amount. And Jeff's view is you can make it $1 million, because if a seller is saying, oh yeah, we promise we're gonna do it, they're gonna do it. So why can't the seller do $1 million? They're never gonna agree to that one, but conceptually it's there. You wanna make sure that you have the money in there. When it's released to you, so we don't wanna leave it as, great, the money's here, but now we're fighting over it. We want to say when it's released and what's going to cause the release. So instead of a it's done, it's not done kind of argument, we can say that the work is considered done upon getting a letter from the trade who did the work and a transfer of the warranty to the buyer. There's something that's physical, we can see it, we know it, it's not arbitrary, and that warranty transfer protects the buyer. So that's just one to grow on.
And then you can release that holdback.
And then the holdbacks get released by the lawyers.
Awesome.
Yeah.
That's great. Wow, so much good information.
It just builds up over the years.
Yes, it does. Yeah. And you can tell Jeff is so passionate about what he does. If you have any questions for Jeff, you can find him at your website is?
Kahanelaw.com.
K-A-H-A-N-E-Law.com. And if you have any questions for me, I'd love to chat. You can contact me anytime. If you are considering fostering or adopting Melina or any other of those wonderful dogs at Positive Match, please contact positivematch.org as usual. They are a wonderful organization and they're always looking for help, looking for your help. So please consider. Have a wonderful week. Thank you, Jeff.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye for now.